It's 1956, and America is having a wonderful dream. Life is good after World War II, for some. Across the white picket fence, though, social divisions widen. The black population isn't equal. Homosexuality is illegal in 49 states. Communism rears its head abroad, spreading a panic known as the Red Scare. Society only smiles on the well-behaved and the politely conformed. Within this reserved culture, we zoom in on a flamboyant blues musician in Fats Domino's band named Jalacy J. Hawkins, who shows up for a performance in a leopard print suit and gold turban. The attention-seeking outfit is the final straw for the laid-back Fats, who fires him from the band on the spot. "Fine," Jay says. "I'll go solo." And he walks out. Back at his Philadelphia apartment, his girlfriend confronts him about infidelity.
She says, "Jay, tell me the truth. If you're doing something and I ask you and you tell me now, we'll stay together. If you lie to me, I'm going to leave you."
He lies. He comes home the next day to an empty apartment. Her clothes, her pictures, her records, gone. Like she never existed at all. He opens his mouth and lets out a blood-curdling scream that surprises even him. 2 weeks later, Hawkins walks into the studio with his band to record a refined blues ballad. He dedicates the song to her. He wants her back. The producer walks in with booze and food to keep the musicians loose. Well, mission accomplished. They record the ballad, blackout drunk. The next day, they wake up in a daze, trying to piece together what happened during the session. Band members have fuzzy memories of Jay singing from the floor on his back, the saxophonist clumsily missing his mouth when he brings the instrument to his lips. They put the tape on and listen to what they made.
"Put a spell on you. Because you're mine. Oh, yeah."
It's definitely not the refined blues ballad they went in for. It's positively demented. And Jay loves it. October 28th. 72% of American households have a television now. That's up from just 9% a few years ago. Millions tune in as rising star Elvis Presley gyrates his scandalous hips on The Ed Sullivan Show. CBS bans shots of his waist in all future broadcasts, but the damage is done. People clutch their pearls even as their pupils dilate. It's the beginning of the end for a decade of sexual repression. The cracks are showing. 3 days later, Jay Hawkins releases his drunken recording of "I Put a Spell on You" on OK Records. This isn't the breezy blues of Fats Domino or even the suggestive slide of Cab Calloway. Now, this is something far darker. It tells the story of an unhinged narrator casting voodoo magic on a woman who doesn't want him. Jay's operatic bellows, chilling screams, and sexual grunts are banned from radio stations across the country. His label releases a version that cuts out the worst of it, but the bans continue. Of course, now everyone wants to hear the record. 1 year passes. Universal Pictures releases Shock Theater, a collection of 52 classic horror films to air every weekend on late-night TV. Kids across the country are introduced to films like Dracula and Frankenstein for the first time. They beg their parents to stay up late. It's the thrill of the week for millions. Meanwhile, Jay Hawkins is touring on the back of his hit single, which found massive underground success despite the radio bans. He's a born showman, leaning into how the public villainized him with voodoo-inspired props and a deranged witch doctor persona. "You think my song is scary? I'll show you scary."
"When he did that, I put a spell on you. You know, this cat scared me, you know, and I'm standing there looking at him."
He doesn't know it, but he's opening the door to a whole new genre of rock and roll, shock rock. During one of his usual over-the-top performances in West Virginia, a woman cries out, "Scream, baby, scream!" From that night forward, he's known as Screamin' Jay Hawkins. 1960. Alfred Hitchcock jolts the film industry with the release of Psycho. From here on out, new horror will take on a darker, bloodier, and more grounded tone. 1962. Bobby Boris Pickett releases the cult classic Monster Mash, one of the first examples of horror tropes being turned into something silly and fun. New horror might be gruesome and gritty, but the old stuff is taking on new life. We'll check on that again in a few years. In the meantime, turn the TV on. Oh, look, it's the Cuban Missile Crisis, bringing the apocalypse to the living room of every American family. The times, they are a-changin'. 1965. The first American combat troops touch down in Vietnam. Bloody scenes from the war are being broadcast nightly from the desk of Walter Cronkite, who will become one of the most influential journalists of all time. 1966. Hey, it's Screamin' Jay Hawkins on the Merv Griffin Show, going over the top now with outlandish props like a cigarette-smoking skull named Henry. They eat it up. Something's different. Less blood drinker, more monster masher. He's kind of funny. Look, even he's laughing. It's 1968. People feel a dread in the air. It'll be one of the most traumatic years in American history. In January, Viet Cong forces launched the largest-scale military offensive in Vietnam to date. In the first phase alone, 300 Americans are dying each week. Days later, a B-52 bomber on a Cold War mission known as Operation Chrome Dome crashes in Greenland with four nuclear bombs on board. Miraculously, they don't explode. In March, Lyndon B. Johnson signs on to the highest level of U.S. troop commitment in Vietnam. 549,500 American citizens are now fighting in the country. The new draft isn't popular at home. In April, MLK is assassinated. It sparks riots across the country. D.C., Chicago, and Baltimore are hit the hardest. 40 people are killed this month in protests. 2 months later, Democratic nominee Robert F. Kennedy is assassinated, throwing the party into disarray. This benefits Nixon, who wins the presidential election on the promise of a just peace in Vietnam. This promise will not be kept. The public reels from the senseless violence and brutal scenes beamed into living rooms on the evening news every night. The threshold for what is considered truly terrifying rises. After all, when your icons and sons are getting gunned down on live TV, lying awake at night because of the Wolfman seems a little silly, doesn't it? But what does that mean for old figures like Dracula, Frankenstein's monster, and a certain voodoo witch doctor? Well, if you grew up begging your mom to watch shock theater on Saturday nights, they aren't terrifying evils anymore. They're an escape to your childhood, away from the harsh reality around you. They're the devils you know, from a time when things weren't so complicated, so gruesome, so real. Their edges blunted, they become ironic tokens of nostalgia for a generation of disaffected youth. Now they're in the monster mash, dancing the night away. The real horrors are here, in this world. And just like that, monsters and aliens and voodoo priests turn from fearsome haunts into familiar kitsch. With this new outlook on horror, artists have two paths. Make something familiar and fun, or push the boundary to shock the audience. In film, we see this split between movies like King Kong embracing the old and the Texas Chainsaw Massacre pushing the new. The same happens in music. Glenn Danzig leads the Misfits into a new subgenre that embraces the corniness of the old horror movies and calls it horror punk. Alice Cooper, Marilyn Manson, and Ozzy Osbourne turn in a more serious direction, following the shock rock tradition of Screamin' Jay Hawkins in a bid to go over the top again and again. And today, I present to you two albums, each carrying on the legacy of one side of the horror schism. On the side of the fun, the kitsch, the old, and the B-flick, is Turn Off the Light by Kim Petras. On the side of the grit, the shock, and the extreme, there existed an addiction to blood by Clipping. Can't play this one. Lyrics are too graphic for YouTube, so you can use the link below if you're curious, and if you dare. Whether they're in film, literature, or music, the quirks of Spooky Season make a lot more sense when we look at them through this dual lens. Simple comic villainy on one end, and the depths of human depravity on the other. But to understand why that dichotomy exists, we should look at the man who represented both to the American public over the course of a decade. His drunken recording scared and offended his audience, but over time, his song and stage show came to symbolize a nostalgic and macabre love of old-school horror. Now, Scream and Jay didn't decide to join the monster mash with Dracula and Frankenstein, or turn from terrifying to amusing. Instead, his work was caught in the cycle all art takes when it sticks around in our minds long enough. It matures, displaced by the new context around us. As artists, we can only hope our work joins the graveyard smash gracefully, greeted by smiles and applause. Hundreds of musicians have covered I Put a Spell on You. Hundreds more will. And every year, I hear its refrain echoed in the film that I lean on for my kitschy Halloween fix.
I put a spell on you. And now you're mine. You can't stop the things I do. I ain't lying.
Happy Halloween, E1s. And remember, don't go out at night.
No running around. I can't stand.